So today's podcast, Timbo, is, and everyone listening, is potentially one of the most important things we should be focusing on in our training, if not the most important, and that is the basics and mastering the basics and sort of, to quote yourself, leaving your ego at the door. It's something that I have some personal experience of not doing, so I can talk from that respect. But yeah, we're going to delve into a little bit of why it is important and probably the most important, and then how we can sort of integrate that into our mindset to then affect our training.
I'm going to keep this intro basic, Jacko. Let's get straight into it. We have got, if you don't know, we've got some programs on our online platform which are entirely designed for people trying to get into calisthenics. It's an area that we are massively passionate about. If you look at things in calisthenics and you kind of go, oh, muscle-ups and handstands and human flags, it looks really complicated. When we first started the School of Calisthenics, it was all about trying to make it more accessible for people to get on board, to get the benefits and the enjoyment out of progressive bodyweight training. So with that in mind, we've got some really good resources. Our Bodyweight Basics Training Program, Beginners Push-Up and Dip Program, our Handstand Program is designed for the beginners. There is so much stuff you can get into if you are at the start of your calisthenics journey.
Yeah, and let's be honest, Timbo. Bodyweight Basics Program, it's got basics written in the title, baby. Like, it says exactly what it says in the tin, like Marmite. Is that right? No, Ron Seal.
Ron Seal.
Marmite. Oh, no, we're in Marmite. Marmite and Ron Seal, they're pretty much similar, aren't they?
Yeah, same. Probably taste the same. yes, so should we get into it, this week's conversation?
Yes, well, I just wanted to point out that the Bodyweight Basics program, had a lot of people obviously been using that as part of their training regime. It's been that popular one that we are going to be producing a course that's going to be 6 weeks long. We're going to be able to work through some live sessions for over the period of 6 weeks, like we've done the mobility course that's currently running. There's going to be one specifically for Bodyweight Basics to work through week by week with a coach live, watch those sessions back, have all of the resources. But rather than just working through it at your own pace, you're going to get some coach-led sessions within that. So that is coming in the future. We haven't got the exact release date for that now, but just keep an eye out for that. If you are interested, you understand you need to do some more work on your basics since you want some help with the basics, and join us for that one when it's announced.
That structure is so important, right? In terms of just having the accountability of a session, you've got the coach to ask questions to, you can get live regressions and progressions. You don't have to kind of do the unpicking of the training program yourself. You can just follow along. There's loads of reasons to get involved in that one. It could be a really nice little kickstart to give you that real platform to delve into some other stuff in calisthenics. So don't miss that out. Don't miss that when it comes out is the order of the words I wanted to say.
All right, let's get in to this week's podcast.
Roll that jingle.
Listen, players. You're listening to the Movement, Strength and Play podcast by the School of Calisthenics. Here are your hosts, Tim and Jacko.
Now, this is always an interesting subject because when there'll be a lot of people out there that will have heard the word in the title basics and thought, that's not for me, boys. I'll listen back in next week. The reality is, I hate to tell you, this is exactly for you. And it's for everybody because the basics are not always basic. Sometimes our interpretation of that can be relative to our progression or our level of training history. I still do a huge amount of basics in my training program, and I'll define what I mean by that. And there's probably two definitions, really. Basics for me are fundamental movements. So that will be horizontal, vertical push and pull patterns. So push-ups, horizontal rows, pull-ups, handstand progression or pike push-up progressions, I should say, would be the vertical pressing patterns. And you just start to scale those as you spend more time in calisthenics. So you can make them more difficult by, let's say the horizontal pull position. You can start with your feet on the floor with the body at a nice tall angle, makes it relatively easy. You can then start to move your feet forward, elevate them on a box, put a weight vest on. That for me is all basics.
Yeah.
They're just referring to the fundamental movement. But the basics in calisthenics, and this is one of the best things about it, are super accessible to anybody who wants to get started. There is always a way that we can dial back a bodyweight movement within those patterns that I just mentioned to make it accessible for somebody who has done zero calisthenics before.
Yeah. And I think that there's that connotation of, you say that word basics, then actually in our head, sometimes like just translating that as like, oh, that just means easy stuff. And if I'm just doing stuff that's easy, I'm not sort of progressing. And that that connotation is like correct to a degree, but it depends on how we're misinterpreting basics and what easy is. So if I'm doing an easy exercise, it doesn't mean it has to, it might be less complex or less like high-end strength work, but it's still like a basic movement that I don't have to make that easy if I make sure that like the load that I'm using or the position I've got my body in for that like makes it still challenging for me. It's rather than like if we're constantly doing stuff that we've talked about this many times, like constantly doing stuff that's like too hard or too complex, like it's just potentially too much demand and too much stress and therefore then less adaptation onto the system. And it makes me think back to we've talked about, I think we actually had a podcast, we've talked about it a few times before. I think we had a title of a podcast being like something about there's no such thing as a magic bullet, or that idea of like searching for the magic bullet, which we often think is like potentially something a bit like bit we haven't discovered yet, and a little bit more, it's going to be complicated potentially, rather than actually if there is a magic bullet, it's probably absolutely mastering the basics. I remember being when we were it might have been the UKSCA conference that we presented at, but someone out, I can't remember if it was that year or not, but there was someone presenting I'm gonna forget his name, but like a big wig and a big dude, like big strong dude and a big wig in the S&C world, and apologies, I can't remember his name, but I think the title of his talk was basics and more basics, and he was talking about from a strength perspective like doing super, like doing things like farmer's carries, of being like that's a basic movement, human movement pattern of like holding something and walking. Now it wasn't necessarily, he didn't make it necessarily easy because he'd have been holding it was a big dude, like he'd have been holding something very, very heavy, but the movement itself was it was considered to be like a basic movement pattern. And I think that really that was a number of years ago and probably really did a really great job of just like hammering that home. And if anyone's like not that sure about, oh well, I don't know boys, like sort of I'm pretty cool at the basics, I just need to like crack on and do some harder stuff, there's no one in the world of training that doesn't have an element of just getting better periods of time where they get better just mastering those basics.
Well, it's all relative, isn't it? Let's take it into like a wider training conversation and go, let's say a bench press might be a basic exercise, like it's that you're lying on a bench and you're pushing a bar of above your chest. That's not a basic exercise if you're doing a one repetition max. It's hard out intensity. The same thing would be for someone doing a power clean. If you've done a lot of power cleans, that becomes a relatively basic exercise, because that's the complex movement like a power clean becomes basic when your central nervous system in your body, your kinetic chain, is able to deliver that, execute that movement pattern, and then it becomes something that you know. A handstand for me is a basic exercise because I've done it so much. So it goes back to what we've talked about your physical literacy or your catalogue of movements that your body knows broadens out, and then those patterns become relatively basic. But what is determined as, to your point, Jacko, around is it basic, and that's always going to be relative to the level of intensity that you're training at. When we're talking about this in calisthenics, I think when we refer to the word basics or the basic exercises, we are thinking about these just real fundamental movement patterns and not chasing more and more complex skills. So for me, doing a handstand would be a relatively basic exercise. I know that's not the same for everybody, but...
And it depends on your journey. Like, you know, when you started, exactly. It wasn't the best. So it ebbs and flows as we develop, right?
Yeah. But doing something like let's take a more complex movement, like a 90 degree handstand push-up, that takes a lot of skill acquisition and a lot of time and specific strength. But what's going to get me better at that movement is just doing more vertical pushing, like in a basic pattern. Yeah. That could be as simple as feet elevated pipe push-ups and getting some volume in there. Or I might go and do something which is going to give me a little bit more intensity, becomes more difficult, so that I'm building more maximal strength rather than a more volume-based adaptation by doing four sets of 10 or whatever it might be. I might be doing five sets of three repetitions to build a different type of strength. But what you're going to find with is that wherever you're at, whether you're learning your first pull-up or you are doing a front lever or something, the basic strength is going to be what underpins everything that you do. And that's when we're probably like to think about a basic movement as skill acquisition is not basic. If you're learning something new, it's not a basic movement because your body doesn't know it. A basic movement is something that you know well and you can do. And that's where it really fits into this strength development type of conversation where we are just building a bigger base all the time, which allows you to go and play at a better level. And my last point before I pass it back over to you, Jacko, is just around this, is if you've got, like, if you're wanting to do something around body composition, in a podcast quite recently, we talked about the Big and Bendy program, which I think might get released on the dark web.
I've written that down on the to-do list, Tim.
I know you have. And somebody messaged in. Someone sent me a message on Instagram and said, I'm all up for the Big and Bendy program.
Oh, Big and Bendy. Get it right. It was Bulk and Bendy.
Bulk and Bendy.
I was going to say, Bulk and Bend. I don't know. Do you like the Y on Bendy or not? I feel like Bulk and Bend is like...
No, I don't know. I like Bendy.
I've actually been thinking about it, of how that could potentially be structured.
Like, we're digressing. But if you wanted to go down that route of you're looking about body composition, then we need volume in the program. And you're not really going to change significant amounts put a big shift in your body composition if you are chasing a skill acquisition all the time, because you've got to be so specific with that work. So just think about everything that you're doing can be underpinned by movements that you are comfortable with, that you're confident with, that you can scale with volume and then hopefully intensity. So even if you can't do a pull-up and that's your number one goal, doing more bodyweight rows, it's a pattern that you know. It's a basic pattern relative to the pull-up. So rather than spending all of your time trying to do pull-up like variations, which you can do with bands and eccentrics, that sort of stuff, there's part of that. But the bottom end of your training program should always be movements that you can just bang out a ton of volume and just really get that strength of the bank, because it's going to feed everything else that you're trying to do.
Yeah, you talk about doing your first pull-up. There was Angie's is a... It's got, you know, when someone's name's got loads of those little like hyphens over like the E's and the A's and things.
Oh, yeah.
Means
accents, umlauts, those sorts of things.
I don't know about that. It means you're like basically probably not English, and like I'd love to have some things on my... Anyway, she was one of the members that's been following the Body Weight Basics program, and she's done her first pull up this week, and we need to... I've asked her whether we can share the video or not, but her smile at the end of that, like, she comes down to pick the camera up and is like so buzzing for that first pull-up, which you always love to see. And I think that one thing I was like, how good that makes us feel mentally when we've done some of those things. Now, that for her, it was the very first one, so is a pull-up a basic fundamental movement, but like, is it basic for us at that point is almost what we're sort of talking about. But once we start to get some of these fundamentals and base, and we start to build up that base, then you've talked about this before, like that's when we get the chance, or we've earned the right to play a little bit of a higher level. And I think the mental side of it is what you described there, I think is really important, that understanding that just because I'm doing, I'll put it this way around, mentally, a lot of us will find it motivating. We've talked about this a number of times, and we've had this own experience. It's motivating, which helps us be consistent when we know we're working towards something that gets us excited. Now, a good example for this would be, there's a few people this week just replying to some messages around to members that are following the Ring Muscle Up program, where there's a couple of people like had the same sort of issue around the transition. And they were asking around like where they should focus their attention during training, and they were struggling with the tricky transition, and then their mind was focused on potentially that as like, I need to do some more like banded transitions, and what else can I do to help with that transition. And you know, we talk about this at workshops, and we said it probably a number of times, that if as a specific for a ring muscle, for example, the basic strength is going to make the difficult transition easier. So working on your pull-up strength and being able to pause at the top is going to help you enter that transition. And then being stronger at the and being deeper in our dip and being able to pause at the bottom of that dip and be comfortable there is going to make you finishing the end point of that transition easier. So I was very much like, let's work on those two basics, the pull-up strength and dip strength and depth and the height of the pull-up and the depth of the dip. And like worry less about that transition, like maybe just a few little bits of banded work to work through it, but we don't need to focus on the complex to get the complex. And I think mentally, if you just say to someone, okay, just get better at pull-ups and just get better at dips, it can be a bit like, oh, but it's just that doesn't necessarily excite me so much. Whereas it's presented to ourselves in a way of like, I'm going to work on my pull-ups, I'm going to work on my dips, I'm going to work on those basics because it's going to help me do that ring muscle-up or that other thing that excites me. So I think the mental side of this is really important, and just putting that spin on it in your own head is going to help you really embrace those basics and really want to master those basics. And I tell you what, when you've done a period of time on them and you've got a smile as big as, I'm going to pronounce the name wrong, but Angie's, then you're going to be invested in those basics. And it's those basics that are going to give you that longevity. It's going to give you that like robustness, and it's just going to give you that sort of feel good factor for your body that you're fully in control of the movement strength. And you do it with us, you're going to have a bit of fun as we play as part of those programs. So yeah, it's all encompassing when you put that, or I feel like it can be all encompassing when you put that spin on it.
Yeah, I wanted to just kind of like start to wrap up my kind of sentiments around this subject on giving people some suggestions of how they could implement this into their training program. So if you are in the sort of the camp that Jacko has just talked about, where you're thinking about, okay, I'm going after this specific goal, it's a muscle up or it's a human flag or whatever it is. If you follow in our training programs, you'll find that our basics work for those kind of programs is in the capacity strength section. So you'll have gone through the movement preparation section, the movement patterning, which is your skill acquisition, and then there'll be some specific strength in the applied strength section, and then there'll be probably two or three exercises in a capacity strength part of the training program. Those are typically just going to be dips, pull-ups, press-ups, variations of those sorts of things. Now, if you're training towards something like a muscle up, it's really easy to kind of just dedicate loads of your session time towards that. Don't get stuck. And sometimes you might need to, and this a handstand is a nightmare for this one, but sometimes what you might need to do is set yourself a clock and go, I'm going to do this for 10, 15 minutes. I've got an hour to train, but I'm going to leave myself 25 minutes just to get basic strength work done, because I promise you, you'll reap the benefits from that. Often if you're trying to do something which is difficult outside of your current ability, the more you try and kind of push that, the more fatigue you're going to get and the less reward or benefits you're going to gain within that session. You're often better just giving yourself a dose of that 15 minutes or 10 minutes, whatever the next movement might demand, and then going, I'm just going to go and build strength on top of this, rather than trying to kind of chase that. I'm just going to get it next time. I'll get over the bar next time, or I'll balance it the next time on my handstand. That route it doesn't yield a huge amount of return. So at that point, you can cut it off and go, right, it's strength development time. And I promise you, you're going to feel the benefits with that, both in the short term for the objective you're working towards, and then also longer term as you go on to go and learn the next progression that you're not even really thinking about yet. But there is one of what you want to go and do next. And you can set yourself up for better success now by building that bigger base of strength. The other camp of people is probably where I'm at. And I'll put myself in the same group of people that are doing bodyweight basics, where I just want to kind of do basics all the time. I'm not really chasing any specific goals at the moment. It might be that my basics program looks a little bit different to somebody who comes in fresh onto bodyweight basics, but the principles are the same. It's a lower body, push, pull, upper body, push, pull hybrid program with some core training. That's what I do 5 days a week, if that's what I can get in training wise. That will be my program. It's not complicated, and I'm probably also mixing in a little bit of strength and play stuff within that as well. So the ring kind of variations, I might start, rather than doing normal push-ups, I might be using the rings to do some archer push-ups or that sort of thing. But again, back to my earlier point, these are patterns that I know well. They're relatively comfortable for me. I can load them with some complexity by changing the number of repetitions I'm doing, the amount of time I hold in a position, whether I put a weight vest on, if I combine it with something else, what the rest period is in between sets, do I do them slower so the tempo is harder or makes it more difficult? All of that sort of stuff is just creating the progressive overload or the stimulus that Jacko mentioned before, and it's just building a bigger depth of my basics. So if you're listening to this and you're sort of like, yeah, but I find the basics quite boring and not that challenging, just go back and do one thing. Go and play around with tempo. Take your 10 dips that you can do for 4 or 5 sets, because they're easy at body weight, and go and do 10 dips with a 4-second eccentric. So you're going to lower down for 4 seconds and then try and do 4 sets of those. Do the same things with your pull-ups, or go and try something like an archer pull-up, and all of a sudden you'll realize that your basics aren't that good. And you go, right, okay, I'm going to go and build this bigger foundation of strength, but I'm just going to go and tweak it. So you've got some new movements to play with, or some new variables which you're going to introduce, which are going to create a brand new stimulus that is going to kickstart your strength development within that phase, which is then also then going to start to go and add some more depth for you. And these are the ways that you build one bigger base of strength for more complex calisthenics movements. Or like me, I just kind of like the basics at the moment. I like going into a session where I haven't got to think of complex skill acquisition. I'm playing around with lots of different things. It meets my objectives from a volume perspective of body composition. To change body comp, we just need to get more volume in across a week at a certain intensity. And you're going to get way more adaptation and results in that area around the basics in calisthenics than you are from chasing super specific movements. So that, because you can do more of it effectively, it's just easier to do more horizontal pushing than it is to kind of get in high acquisition skill movements. So have a think about how you might be able to break some of this stuff down. But whatever camp you're in, whether you're training for a specific movement, get basics in. Whether it's within a human flag session or it's a separate session to its a different part of the week, or if you are just kind of joining bodyweight basics or looking to just kind of do real kind of what we might call as more simple training with patterns that we know, start playing around with some of those variables that I mentioned, and you're going to all of a sudden realize that basics are not that basics, and there's lots and lots of road left ahead of you to continue to progress down.
Yeah, and I just wanted to pick up on one thing that was like where you made a good point around like handstands could be an example where, or depending on what you're doing in your training, you can spend that much time messing about trying to get this. I'm going to get it next time. You actually, even if I go back to that ring muscle up example, like spend too much time on the transition, going, I'm going to get it next time, and actually you don't do the strength work that's going to get you there. One example would be, I'll see whether you've been there on this, Tim, but people listening, like I'm sure some people, I can't be the only one that's done this, where you're like, you think you're really, you're like, oh, something just felt really good. You get the camera out because this next one's going down. Like I got this next one. And then you get your camera. And then when you've got your camera out, you've made this like commitment to yourself where you're like, I'm going to get it. And then basically you don't get it, but you like still feel good. But you've like, you've sort of half videoing, you know, well, that's a good fail. Maybe I'll keep that fail for later once I've got it. And then you're like chasing in this session becomes this thing of like trying to get the thing that you thought you did. Or maybe you did one, but you didn't record it. So if it wasn't on Instagram, it didn't happen. So do you know what I mean? Almost like getting into that. And something we will encourage people to do is to video what they're doing in the session so they can see what they're doing, get some feedback from it. But it's like anything, it can be a bit of a double-edged sword. And I think that there'll be some people will probably be laughing along going, yeah, I've been there, and I know I've wasted 15 minutes of my training session trying to get the right
video thing.
So use the video. Absolutely. As and when is necessary, but another example where you may fall into a little bit of a trap where ultimately you're just not getting strong. You're just getting good with the camera.
Yeah, you make a great point, and the calisthenics can be so distracting with that. But one of the biggest things that you're going to need to do with basics training is density. You're just going to pack work into a session. So just like I find that my watch is super useful for that in terms of, like I said, I've got a Garmin, so you can set it to strength training, and then it gives you my rest periods, and you just try and be strict to those. So it's a 60 or 90 second rest, and then you back in. Don't try and like, don't let yourself get distracted. And if you're in the gym with other people, that can be quite challenging as well. But just be really focused on what you're trying to do, and just pack in work into that 45 minutes. In basics, you don't need an hour and a half. I promise you that, to get a good workout. You can get plenty of work done in 30 to 45 minutes to create enough stimulus. And if you're bagging those sessions on a daily basis and then consistently over a number of weeks, you're going to start to really see the benefits. Yeah. Just keep chasing that intensity to make sure it stays difficult. Remember, if you're finishing a set with this kind of work, where we're talking like, let's take horizontal rows as an example, if you're leaving four or five, maybe two reps in the bank of a 10 rep set, so you can do 10, but you could have done 12, 13 or 14 repetitions of that intensity, you need to make it more difficult because your body can do what you're asking it to do, so there's therefore no stimulus for it to adapt. So keep trying to nudge that on and keep a training diary. These things, we sometimes, it's much, much easier to quantify them if you know from 1 week to the next, last week I did 3 sets of 8. So this week, I'm either going to go and try and do 3 sets of 9, which is progressive overload. We've done more than what we've done before. Or I'm going to go and do 4 sets of 8. Or I might even go 4 sets of 6 if I can't do that. But somehow we're looking to nudge that volume and intensity across a number of weeks to really build that depth.
Yeah. It was just, it made me think of the bulk. When you said density, I just immediately thought of the Bulk and Bendy program, and like how you match periods of strength work with bendy work. I'd be lying if I said I wasn't doing some experimental work in my own training around the Bulk and Bendy program. Soon to be released.
It's a difficult one because you end up getting, like, you don't want to be too bendy for bulk work. Like,
well,
you don't want to be too bendy when you're like then going to go and try and create a significant amount of fatigue in the muscle.
So it's when and where it fits in. There's nothing cooler. Well, there is, but it's fairly cool when you see, you know, like a proper mega bodybuilder. But then when they do their like their pose where they like slide, they're doing like a Cossack squat, but they're like basically in the splits because they're that that flexible. And everyone goes, oh, I thought if you're really muscly, you couldn't be flexible. Like, damn.
Yeah. Yeah, think again.
He's basically on the Balkan Bendy program and has been for a long time.
Right, we're going to sign off this week. So I hope that's been useful and encourage you to go and play around with the basics. There's a lot of enjoyment to be had in it. And if you think it's boring, as I said, go and play around with some new variables or go and have a look in our strength and play tutorials library and just get a few. Don't go for the super complicated stuff. Go for a few things that just look like, oh, that's a different type of push-up or pull-up that I've not done before. I'm going to try and slot that into my program. And you're going to start to really, you get some of that buzz that you get when you're doing skill acquisition-based calisthenics for the bigger movements. But I know for a fact, if my pull-ups are okay, my archer pull-ups are not. Like, the archer pull-ups is a different level. And I might be able to go from doing 10 pull-ups to be able to get in, like, maybe 4, 5, or 6, like, yeah, archers. It's just a completely different different demand, really, in many ways. And that freshens things up for me. I like it.
Yeah. Tim mentioned there the strength and play programs that we have inside the virtual classroom. There is currently, for the month of October, a special discount on the if you've got a membership, it's already part of your membership, so you're all good. But if you haven't got a membership yet and you're interested in having a little bit more play in your training, the strength play tutorials and the conditioning workouts as a special bundle, it would normally be 100 quid, but it's a 33% discounts as a third off, so it's 67 quid for those. The link will be in the show notes to check that out if you want to spice up your training basics and have a little bit of strength and play in your life and in your training. Then do check that one out. As I say, if you're already a member, whether you're standard membership or VIP, it's already part of your membership, baby, so you can just dive right in.
It's worth noting on that one, though, it's not the strength and play tutorials. Let me just give you a little bit of more information about it. Within that, there's like movement exercises, play-based movement exercises. So there's mobility as part of that. There's loads of strength stuff in there, and there's some stuff which is we call play, but it's just a lot of fun things. So there's push and pull variations, there's some core stuff. There's loads of things to get you to challenge you to move in different
lower
ways.
Body
so if you like the mobility
well, yeah,
and you want to get strong, there's tons of stuff in there. There's pistol squats tutorial in there, like 5, 6 exercises that will get you towards that. There's like, it's packed. It is a gold mine within a gold mine of the online training programs. What more could you want?
There you go. Check it out if you haven't done right already, team. And
so that's it. That's our conversation around basics. Let us know how you get on, and we look forward to seeing your progress and experimentation.
Yeah. So if you if you've an avid listener to the podcast, or whether this is your very first one, but if you haven't given us a review yet, we'd really appreciate a review on iTunes, Spotify, or wherever it is that you listen to the podcast. It really does help the podcast grow and reach more people. And if you got any feedback for us or any potential topics or guests you'd like to see us try to weasel our way into, then do email us or send us a message on social. Instagram's probably the best place for that, or emails are david@schoolcalisthenics.com or tim@schoolcalisthenics.com. We look forward to hearing from you. And if you've got a friend or a loved one that you think they don't spend enough time on the basics, this is a podcast for them. Send it to them with our love and introduce them to the podcast.
It's actually a metaphor for life. Do the basics better. There's not many areas that you're not going to get better if you do the basics, even like, I don't know, cooking,
cooking, cleaning.
Yeah, I don't know. That list could go on for a while. But anyway, enjoy that. And until we speak to you again, keep exploring your physical potential with movement, strength, and play.
Class dismissed.